Next week is birthday Sunday, so we'll have our birthday brunch. July 28th, Ann will be away, and I'm going to take the week off. So we will skip a week in our children's Bible stories series. And Bob Pruitt of the Gideons will be coming and making a presentation about how the Gideons are doing and giving, I'm sure, an interesting discussion about the work that they do, which he does each time he comes. This past Wednesday, our Bible study and prayer was not here in the church because I came all the way up and I forgot my Bible. And I wasn't going to drive all the way back and all the way back up again because it was hot in here anyway. This week, the temperature is supposed to be even higher than last Wednesday, so I'm going to just do Zoom again. So for those of you who come to our Bible study, just I'll send out the Zoom link. And I think that's it for announcements. Does anyone else have any announcements this morning? Then let us take our songs and voices to the Lord today.
Will be our God even to the end. I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no
gathered, mended, and whole. Mark, Allison wants prayer request for her best friend's father.
Yep, father?
Best friend's father.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we were all shocked and dismayed last night to see the horrible event that happened with former President Trump. We know that there is evil in this world. We know that there is violence in this world, but we reject it. And we know that you reject it, Lord. We lift up the family of the man who was killed. We lift up those two people who were injured and their families. We lift up President Trump, who certainly had probably the scare of his life. And Lord, we just pray against the violence that we see around this world. There's just so very many, many people dying, being injured. People in Ukraine, people in the West Bank, people in the area, other areas of Israel. And Lord, we just pray, and in Israel itself, in the Jewish communities. We just pray, Lord, for an end to this violence. And we know that the Bible has said that it will be with us, and that it may even get worse as we go into the end times. But Lord, we just pray that peace comes upon the earth. We pray that you will help in this presidential election to keep everyone safe and sane during this time, and that your chosen one, whoever that may be, is elected to the president. We have humiliating and embarrassing things happening in our American election today. And the whole world, I'm sure, is watching and finding it, if not humorous, then frightening, as we all do. And so, Lord, we just pray for your hand to be in this, to be part of all of this, and for sanity to rule, and for safety to rule, and ultimately for peace to rule. We pray that you will bring shalom on this country and upon this world. Lord, we thank you that we're able to be here today, that there is still freedom in the United States to come together and pray together and worship together. We are just so grateful that we're able to come to this old historic building, this small but lively and faithful group of people who make up this church and our visitors. And we're just grateful that we're all able to be here, and we worship you and praise you because you are the one who has made this possible. And you are the one, Lord, who calls for us, who calls for us to open our hearts to you, to ask you to come in, to change our lives. Lord, we pray that you will do that for each person here who has not yet accepted you as Savior, that you will work on their hearts, their minds, their souls, and that they will come to know you as you are, our dear and wonderful Lord, powerful and mighty, and yet merciful and forgiving, and so loving. You who want to have a personal relationship with each person that you have created. So we pray, Lord, that you will open hearts and minds through the Holy Spirit here this morning, and that your Spirit will fill this room today, and that we'll each go away with a greater understanding of who you are and a greater portion of your love in our hearts. We pray for this church and for its future. and for all the people who are here, Lord. We pray that you will help us to worship you properly and to put you always first. Lord, this morning we have special prayer requests for Allison's best friend's father. We don't know the circumstances, but you do. We pray for Allison's sisters and the rest of her family. In every family there are troubles. And so we just pray that you will be present with their families and with all families. We pray for Chris, who had a medical procedure this week and is unable to be with us today. We pray for traveling mercies for Charlie as he travels south to his son's to spend the day or perhaps a few days for the summer. We pray for the persecuted church worldwide, for the homeless and the hopeless. We pray for our young people and the young people around the world. This world is such a difficult place to live now. There are so many competing beliefs. And where do you turn? What do you believe? Well, we put on, Lord, that we believe in you. And we pray that more and more people will believe that. We thank you for traveling mercies for Peggy's family, who traveled to England and Germany, and for Ann and for Peggy as they traveled to Denver. No, Ann and Tara as they traveled to Denver.
And Peggy.
Later in July. And we thank you for the rain that we got, and our well is working, and we're just glad of that. And Pam, I don't know the last name here, Pam Back, perhaps with pancreatic cancer. Lord, there is much pain in the world. There is much worry. There is much confusion. And we know that you alone are the answer. And so we lift all of this up to you, and we pray that in this country and around this world, more and more people will understand and realize that you are the only answer, and you are the only promise of everlasting life. And so we pray that you will have your impact on this world, on each one of us individually, on this church. We pray that we may serve you ever better, our holy, holy Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
It is time for our offering this morning, and I would ask that Nancy come forward.
Song.
And everybody has to stand up.
That's Veronica's rule.
have the camera on you.
You have to watch Johnny.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'd rather put it on you. Okay.
Now, as part of this summer series of children's Bible stories, we, as you know, are doing a song each week. I left it to Veronica to pick them, so you can blame her.
How many songs do you know about Abraham?
I don't know.
This is like my class.
So have fun. We'll all be a bunch of kids today.
Father Abraham has many sons, and many sons have Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord right now.
Abraham had perhaps a more significant impact on the world than than any other man, second to Jesus, maybe Moses, but way out there, right? He was the man whom God chose to bring monotheism into the world, a world that was rife with paganism and false gods. And by so doing, Abraham became the father of three religions, the three major religions of the world today: Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And those religions continue to have an impact on this world 4,000 years after Abraham's death, and will, until this world ends, have an impact. In some ways good, in some ways bad. So this morning in our Children's Bible Stories Revisited Summer Series, we're going to jump ahead another 400 years, and we've already covered 1,650 years or so, so we're going to about 2,000 years since Adam and Eve now, to the life of Abraham. We ended last week in Genesis 9 with Noah and his family disembarking from the ark to repopulate the earth with all the animals after the great flood. In the rest of chapter 9 and chapters 10 and 11 are the story of Noah's son Ham, who committed a grave sin, and therefore the Canaanites, Ham and his descendants, which were the Canaanites, were cursed by Noah and by God. Also in that space is the construction of the Tower of Babel, when human beings decided that they would glorify themselves rather than glorify God, and they built a giant structure to prove that they could and to prove that they were as good as God. And so God took their language and broke it up into many languages and scattered them around the earth. And so today we have all different languages. Nancy's French, and some people's various Asian languages and so forth. He confused the language of humans so that they, at that time, hopefully could stop thinking they were as good and as powerful as God. Of course, we all know how well that came out, because so many people continue to think that. And then we come to the story of Abraham. Abraham is a descendant of Noah's son Shem. Noah had three sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. And this is the descendant of Shem and how his line continued. Abraham's story is among the longest in the Bible. It covers 15 chapters in Genesis. Just goes on and on and on. It includes many well-known stories, such as the destruction of sinful Sodom and Gomorrah, the near sacrifice of Isaac by Abram as a test of Abraham's faith, Abraham's sin in Egypt when he told the Pharaoh that Sarah, his wife, was indeed his sister, to protect his own safety, and the sins that came around as a result of that, and Abraham's meeting with the great priest and king of Salem, Melchizedek, who many believe was the pre-incarnate Jesus, who is our priest and king now, today. So I recommend that everyone read these chapters in Abraham's story from Genesis 11 to 25. But today we'll focus just on the journey that Abraham took from Ur of Chaldees, it's called, to Canaan, and then the story of his two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. And again, this week, because we're doing children's stories, I put together another slideshow of the children's story about Abraham. So it begins with this one, Abraham, father of nations. You can just go ahead forward. God told Abram, and his name was not Abraham yet, told Abram to take his family from their home in Ur of the Chaldeans and to go to Canaan. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, God said. So they left Ur, but stopped in Haran, and settled there until his father Terah died. Then God sent Abram and his family on to Canaan. It was a long journey, nearly 500 miles. At Shechem, God promised Abram that his descendants would possess the land, even though he had no child. I will make you into a great nation, God said. Abram built an altar to the Lord. Abram stayed in the land for many years. Then he asked God how he could have many descendants when he had no child. God told him to look at the night sky. He said, count the stars if you can count them. So shall your offspring be. When Abraham's wife Sarai, she wasn't Sarah yet, heard this, she laughed, for she was already old. But Sarai had a servant named Hagar. She told Abraham to have a child with her. Perhaps I can build a family through her, she said. When Hagar became pregnant, Sarai was jealous and abused her. So she ran away. An angel sent her back, saying God would protect Ishmael, her son. He will be a wild donkey of a man and will live in hostility toward all his brothers, he said. Hagar bore Ishmael, and he grew into a young man, and Abram loved his son. God came to Abram when he was 99 years old, and Sarai would soon bear him a son. He would now be called Abraham, which means father of many. Sarai would now be called Sarah, which means princess. Abraham asked God to also bless Ishmael. God said, I will surely bless him. He will be the father of 12 rulers, and I will make him into a great nation. When Sarah gave birth, she was 90. God named the boy Isaac, meaning he laughs, because Sarah laughed when God said she would conceive in her old age. And she laughed when she had the baby. Abraham held a feast after Isaac's birth, but Sarah saw Ishmael mocking the child. And she told Abraham, send them away. Abraham was troubled, for he loved his son. But God said, do not be distressed. Do as Sarah says, because Isaac's descendants will carry on your name. But I will also make Ishmael into a nation, because he too is your offspring. So Abraham gave some food and a skin of water to Hagar and sent her off with the boy. Abraham and Sarah raised Isaac in the land of Canaan, and from them came a great nation of God's chosen people. Obviously, we skipped a lot. A lot of things happened in this story. Some good things, some not so good things. The story of Abraham and Sarah at its simplest level is a story of one couple's frustration trying to have children to carry on their lineage, and of God's intervention to make that happen. But it is so much more than that. That's just a very simple, almost childish perspective on this story. It's the story of God making himself known in a pagan world where people had come to worship many false gods. And it's a story of the revelation of God's plan to bring humanity into an eternal relationship with him. Abraham lived in the land of the Chaldeans, a region that later became Babylonia, and today is the country of Iraq. His father, Terah, was a craftsman and is believed to have been a maker of idols. And so no doubt Abraham was greatly influenced by his father's beliefs, and also by the beliefs of his culture. He was no doubt a pagan and worshipped various gods, as the rest of the people did where he lived. And yet God chose Abraham for a religious revelation and a journey that would change the world. Now we know with Adam and Eve, there was only one God. But in the ensuing years, things had changed. And so many, many gods were being worshipped, false gods. So the story begins with God telling Abraham to leave his country and travel thousands of miles to Haran, and later hundreds more miles to Canaan, where God would make him the father of a chosen people. Of course, there were no buses or airplanes or cars, and so that meant going with, as you saw in the story, going with camels and donkeys and carrying your things. And so Abraham and his family undertook this journey with several members of his family, and they settled in Haran until the death of his father. It doesn't tell us how long that was, but it could have been up to 20 years that they stayed in Haran. Then they continued south to Canaan after his father's death. Now, during all those years, the many in Haran, and then as he came into Canaan, and the years in Canaan, Abraham remained childless despite God's promise that he would be the father of many nations. Now imagine the depth of Abraham's frustration as God kept repeating this promise over and over again and nothing came of it. Before he left Haran, he said, "I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing." Then later in Canaan, he said, "To your offspring I will give this land." Years passed and God promised again, I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. And again later, "I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore." It is no wonder that Abraham challenged God at one point, next slide, saying to him, "Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir." What a sense of frustration and desperation in that man's words at that point. Now, his wife Sarah was probably even more frustrated because women were considered responsible for infertility in those days. If Abraham didn't have a son, it was Sarah's fault, whether it was or it wasn't in those days. Now people today who have dealt with the frustration of infertility, not being able to have a child when they want to, certainly understand the frustration, the despair, the disillusionment that comes with that, how disheartening it is. Today there are many more options for overcoming it. But in those days, there was only one. And so it's no wonder that Sarah, who was by now in her 70s, was so frustrated that she decided to resort to the only method available at that time to give Abram and herself a child. Genesis 16, 1-2a says, "Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, 'The Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her.'" Now, to our Christian way of thinking, this is clearly a sin to do this. But for Sarah and Abraham, it was a culturally accepted method of growing a family. In the 1920s, a huge cache of ancient tablets was discovered in an archaeological dig near Etznuzi near Haran in Turkey. right near where Abraham and Sarah had lived for some years. And it was dated from around that very same time that Abraham and Sarah had lived there. It was mostly legal documents. And among those legal documents was a prenuptial agreement, believe it or not, from 4,000 years ago between a man and a woman. And it said, if Gleminu bears children, Shanima shall not take another wife. But if Gleminu fails to bear children, Gleminu shall get for Shanima a woman from the Lulu country, a slave girl, as concubine. In that case, Gleminu herself shall have authority over the offspring. So this is not new, this practice of having children, marrying children through what that word is, I can't remember, and didn't write it down.
Surrogate.
A surrogate mother, thank you very much. This was a very practical method of growing a family. And we see it again two generations later when Jacob had children with two different wives and their two maidservants. Of course, we see it in the extreme of Solomon with 600 wives and concubines. But practical or not, it was not God's way. God had said clearly in the Bible that a man should have but one wife, not two wives, but one wife. And more than that, this act showed a lack of trust in God, did it not? God had said again and again and again, you will have children. You will be the father of nations. He'd been telling them that for years. So this was a sin. And it ended up creating many unanticipated problems for Abraham and Sarah. Problems that continue in our world today. So Abraham did what Sarah asked. He slept with Hagar, the slave. And she became pregnant. And immediately the problems began. Right away. Sarah immediately became jealous. I mean, she'd been waiting 30, 40 years now to have a child, and here is this young Egyptian slave carrying a child. What should be her child? Why couldn't she have this baby? And so she became jealous, and she took that out in an abusive manner on Hagar. Well, Hagar ran away into the wilderness, where she was confronted by an angel of the Lord. Now, it's interesting, because if you read the scripture very carefully, you will see that, indeed, this angel of the Lord was actually God himself. The passage in the NIV translation says, she gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. So she identifies him there as a God. But if you look at the original Hebrew, in a transliteration, it says, she gave this name, she called the name of Yahweh. That was the name of our God, the God, who spoke to her. She said, you are El Roy. And we've all heard that. Mm-hmm. The God El Roy, the God who sees. She also said, I have seen here the back of Ra. Ra being the one who sees, or Rea, as probably knows, the one who sees. Now, in theology, this is called a theophany. It's a visible manifestation of God. And as you read through the Old Testament, we find these in numerous places in the Old Testament. And it typically says an angel of the Lord, but then as you read on, it begins to identify that, quote, angel of the Lord as the Lord himself. And many people believe that this was the pre-incarnate Jesus, the one member of the triune God who had the capability to appear as a human being on earth. Well, God promised Hagar that if she returned to Abraham and Sarah, he would protect her and her son. And he also told her that Ishmael's descendants would be many. So Hagar returned, and when Ishmael was born, Abraham loved his son. Oh, he loved his son. You can see him playing with him. You can imagine him playing with the boy and taking him fishing and hunting and all those fun things. And they built a relationship. But not Sarah. She couldn't accept it. She still had no child, even though Hagar's child was supposed to be her child. She was going to raise it as her child. But she couldn't do it. And so she was the odd person out in this trio. Ishmael had a mother, Hagar, and a father, Abraham, and Sarah had nothing. It was another 14 years before Sarah became finally pregnant with Isaac. 14 years of watching this going on. And then it was another 3 years of this fragile family relationship before the veneer of fragility just shattered at a party that was held for Isaac's weaning. Weaning was done around the age of 3. And so 3 years passed, and then at this celebration that was held, a time of great joy and excitement. The boy is growing up. 14, 17-year-old Ishmael was sitting there. And Sarah thought she saw Ishmael mocking Isaac, a little 3-year-old. And it was enough. She'd had enough. She couldn't do it anymore. She could not take it anymore. But Ishmael and Isaac were starting to become friends too. They were brothers. And Hagar was in the middle of all this. She couldn't handle it. She had enough. So she told Abraham he must send away the slave woman and her illicit child. Send them away. This must have been torture for Abraham. He had raised this boy for 16 or 17 years now, and he loved him. But God told Abraham to do what Sarah had asked, because Abraham's responsibility was with Sarah and Isaac. He had married Sarah. Isaac was his son by his wife. And Isaac's descendants would be God's chosen people. As for Ishmael, God said that his descendants would also become a great nation. He would have 12 tribes, just like Isaac would have 12 tribes. But he also said that they, Ishmael's descendants, would live in hostility with Isaac's descendants. No surprise for Isaac and Ishmael, given the circumstances of where they came from. But that would be passed down through the generations. Now, the story of Isaac and Ishmael ends with a few verses in Genesis 25. Sarah died at the age of 127. Abraham remarried, and he had 6 more kids. We don't know anything about them, really. And then the Bible tells us, almost parenthetically, that Abraham left everything he had to Isaac. And to his other sons, he gave gifts. And then he sent them away to the land in the east. He was protecting that descendancy of Isaac's. He didn't want anyone to present any threats to Isaac's claim to God's promise of a chosen people. Now, Isaac and Ishmael came together one last time to bury their father next to his wife. Abraham lived to age 175. And when he died, Isaac and Ishmael buried them next to Sarah in the family tomb near Mamre in Canaan. And then the story concludes with Genesis 25:11, which says, after Abraham's death, God blessed his son Isaac, who then lived near Beer Lahai Roy. The name of this place southwest of the Dead Sea means the well of him who lives and sees me. Well of him who lives and sees me. So while that ends Abraham's story, an exciting story it is, and there's a lot more to it than Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot choosing to break away from Abraham, Lot being taken hostage by six kings, and Abraham going after them and defeating the kings, and there's just all this side stuff that's happening. But this is the basic story of the descendancy that came to the Jewish people, and that eventually came to the Christian people and the Muslim people. So while this ends his story, the repercussions of this story continue even today. Abraham became the father of nations, just as God said. But those nations did not live in peace and harmony. As you continue through the Bible, there's story after story after story of the Jews, the Hebrews, the Israelites, battling with the people around them, people trying to take their land. And in some cases, the Israelites trying to take their land. And it went on and on. Generation after generation after generation. Bruce Steeler was one of my favorite authors. He's a Jewish man who wrote a book called Walking the Bible, which I recommend to anybody. He had turned away from his Jewish faith, and he wanted to go back and put himself into the Bible. And so he went and spent an entire year walking from place to place, mentioned in the Old Testament, and interviewing people, talking to people, learning the legends, and learning the stories, and wrote this amazing book that was turned into a movie called Walking the Bible. And after he did that, he wrote a book called Abraham, A Journey to the Heart of Three Faiths. And he wrote this. Despite countless revolutions in the history of ideas, Abraham remains a defining figure for half the world's believers. Muslims invoke him daily in their prayers, as do Jews. He appears repeatedly in the Christian liturgy. The most mesmerizing story of Abraham's life, his offering a son to God, plays a pivotal role in the holiest week of the Christian year at Easter. The story is recited at the start of the holiest fortnight in Judaism on Rosh Hashanah. The episode inspires the holiest day in Islam, Eid al-Adha, the feast of the sacrifice at the climax of the pilgrimage. And yet, the religions can't even agree on which son he tried to kill in that sacrifice. For Christians and Jews, it was Isaac. But for Muslims, it's Ishmael. Ishmael is the hero of the story. Ishmael is the one from whom they descended. And so there is this friction, this disunity, this contest almost between the religions. Religions that make up almost half of the world's population. There are many, many more things on which they cannot agree besides who went on that pilgrimage to the top of Mount Moriah, where Abraham was ready to sacrifice his own son's life in obedience to God before God stopped him. Sadly, when God told Abraham that his two sons would live in hostility to one another, it was a pronouncement for the ages. Throughout history, this conflict has continued, and we see it today. All we have to do is look east to the Middle East, where war is continuing on, where some Arab countries have promised to destroy the evil Jews, and where the Jews have promised to destroy the terrorists, Islamists. And so it goes on and on. But although this is one of the outcomes of the story of Ishmael and Isaac, I don't believe this is the lesson that God wants us to take away from this story. I think God would have us recognize in the story his great love for all people. Because if you look into the story, he didn't pick between Isaac and Ishmael. He loved them both, as Abraham loved them both. God loved them both. And he gave them both a future. And he gave them both a heritage. And so it isn't God who creates this problem. He loved Abraham and Sarah. But he equally loved Hagar. He saved her in the desert twice, if you read the story. He loves Isaac's descendants. We are his descendants spiritually in this church. But he also loves Ishmael's descendants. He loves them. Because God loves all the people he created, no matter their faith, no matter their belief. There is no competition for God's love between the religions that came down from Abraham, because God does not pick favorites. God is not on the side of the Jews or the Muslims. He wants the war to end. Nor does God discriminate, and neither should we. We should love all as God loves all. I think God would also have us take away from this story a lesson about how important it is to trust him, because that was the basic fault here. God told these people over and over again, you will have a son. Trust me, it's going to happen. And yet, they couldn't accept that. They had to take the matter into their own hands. If they had only been patient and trusting, if they had not willfully pursued their own efforts to solve the problem, if they had not yielded to what was culturally accepted, but not acceptable to God, then the world today may be a totally different place. One family's choice can make that big a difference. So I hope you take those two thoughts away. Trust God. Wait on God. He makes us promises. He will fulfill them. We just need to wait and be patient and put our trust in him. And while we're waiting, to love one another, and it doesn't matter what color we are, what country we're from, what nation we stand up in and raise the flag. It doesn't matter what gender we are. We are to love all people because God created us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so very grateful, again, for these stories that you put in the Bible and the messages that they bring, and we are mere humans, and we are terrible, terrible at putting these stories into practice in our own lives. We want to control our lives. And yet, we know that's not what you are asking. And so we pray for your help, Lord. We pray for you to give us new ability to do that, new incentive to do that. We pray that you will forgive our sins, because we will fail and do fail. But we pray, Lord, that you will stay with us, be our strength, and be our great help in this difficult world in which we live. And we pray this in Jesus' name. After church this morning, we have the history committee. There are also several things that we did not cover last week in the chat, church chat. and an update on one thing we did, and so I would like to ask that during fellowship, you give me your attention for a few minutes, and we will talk about those things from church chat. Our final song is Take My Life. Along the way. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.